This week we're going to finish up this New Beginnings series. I've been talking about kind of this circle of our lives, this idea that orientation, deorientation, reorientation. So we find ourselves at moments in our lives when things are going well and everything's going correctly and we're oriented, and then some event occurs in our lives and we become disoriented. And then eventually we reach that point where our life begins to get back to normal. We begin to reorient ourselves and we rebuild and we come out of it and we work our way back to those times when it is happy, normal, whatever you want to call that orientation time. And so we have been talking about this for the last 3 weeks, because when I put this sermon series together, we were headed out of COVID. But it appears as though we have switched the tack of that ship, and we are skirting with the edge of being right back in the middle of COVID. So here I thought I was getting us ready for reorientation right on the edge, and now we're disoriented again. And I decided to go forward with this sermon series because we need to be looking at and knowing that this cycle of life continues. I talked last week about how people who are older have hope in their top three emotions, and how because they have been through so many cycles of this orientation, disorientation, reorientation, they know that things will get back to normal, and they have hope. And how younger people have less hope because they don't have that experience. This week, I want to talk to you about kind of what is it that through this process we have acquired anew. And it was interesting this week. So, one of the things that we have acquired through this, I found out that there was like a 4,000 to 5,000% increase in this one area of our lives that had existed in a very small measure, but will probably exist in a much larger measure as we go forward. Have you been thinking about what it is? Online doctor visits. In the height of the pandemic, there was a 5,000% increase of the number of online Zoom-style, FaceTime-style visits that we had with doctors. So I thought, well, that can't be true. But then I thought about it. We've been doing online visits for a while in our house. And it's been amazing. Like, we had 6 or 7 visits with a new person in our medical field before we actually met him in person. It was incredible. Some of the other things that we have learned anew. So, I don't know if you've done this, but I've done this. Grocery shopping without going in the store. Did you do that? Now, I think I'm the kind of person that wants to get back in the store. Because, well, needless to say, nobody can pick out a pineapple like I can pick out a pineapple. Nobody can pick out asparagus like I can pick out asparagus. Nobody can pick out a cantaloupe like my wife can pick out a cantaloupe. She always complains when I pick out the cantaloupe. It's either overripe or underripe. Some kind of magic squeeze thump thing she does. I don't know what it is. I don't understand it. She tried to explain it to me. And no matter how much you put in the instructions, they will not smell your fruit before they send it to you. Well, don't you smell your fruit? I do. But during COVID, I would pull up to the grocery store, put down the tailgate on my truck, climb back in my truck, and the groceries that I wanted would magically appear in the back of my truck. They would also be magically charged to my credit card. And sometimes there would be substitutions that I wasn't happy with. Oh, I love those. Don't give me that yogurt. I'll get in trouble if I take that yogurt home. There's a particular brand of yogurt that is better than all the other yogurt. I'm not going to advertise for them here. But needless to say, I turn all other yogurt away. And I've learned how to do that online. Just let them know that you don't want a substitution for that item. It's been made easy. That is one of those things that is maybe going to stick a little bit, but not as much as they thought. There's research out there. People have done research to say the things that we're doing anew, are you going to keep or are you going to get rid of? Grocery shopping is one of the things that a lot of people are going to go back to. 80% of people said they want to get back in the grocery store who used online shopping. 80% of the people who used online physician stuff said they want to keep doing that. It was completely the opposite. One of the things that people haven't enjoyed online is school. Both children and parents want kids to go back to school for two very different reasons, I'm sure, but only about 20 or 25% of the people want to continue with online learning. How many of you are currently working from home? Anybody working from home? Yeah, there's people working from home. Teachers did online working from home last year, a few. People in business. My daughter, whose full-time job is, well, kind of boring as far as I'm concerned. She's a financial aid counselor. She does 4 days remote, 1 day in the office. That whole idea of being able to work from home. Companies have seen increased customer satisfaction, decreased costs for office space. Car buying. I don't know if Ohio has it. I didn't do my research well. But there are some places that you can completely buy a car and it will be delivered to you. And you don't even have to sign anything. You can sign all the papers online and they will deliver your car to you. Completely online. I don't know about you, but I at least, again, it's like my fruit. I want to smell my car before I get it. Right? I want to know if the person before me was really a closet smoker and they're trying to cover it up with that stuff and they say it'll never be there, but it really is there. Car dealerships have also gone to people call in to get service on their car. The car dealership comes out, picks up your car, takes it, gets the work done, returns it back to you. You never have to go into the dealership. I'm like, oh, that can't be true. I checked. You can do it here in Lima. It's amazing. All of these things that we have learned to do because of COVID. And the real question is, what are we going to keep and what are we going to get rid of? So one of the things that I mentioned was wearing a mask to avoid the flu. I should have started wearing my mask last week because I caught this cold. Oh, well. Missed it by just a week, I guess. What are the things that you're doing now that you didn't do before that you're going to keep? So one of the things that we did here at church is we started making church service available online. So one of the goals that we had before COVID was to get our service online. And we had just started doing that when COVID hit. We were in the process of getting ourselves online. How many of you remember those first few weeks online? The sound was terrible. The picture was terrible. We didn't know whether we were recording in the middle or in the back. And now look at us. We have a camera mounted to the wall. Just because you can do it doesn't mean you should do it, but they can zoom in really close on my face. And I don't like it when they do that. And I don't know that they did it until I go back and I look at it later. The sound is better. The picture quality is better. Things have improved, and we have, usually on Sundays, 30 to 40 people watching. And then throughout the week, we actually have more people who watch our Sunday service than show up here on Sunday morning. Who knew? Who knew that people would be interested in watching a service online? The thing that amazes me is there are people who watch our service who are nowhere near us. People from North Carolina, people from Florida, people from New York, people from Michigan, just to name a few. Regular Sunday attenders. They're here with us 3 and 4 Sundays a month. We're reaching more people. So those are all marvelous things, Pastor, but what does that have to do with the power of us? And the reality is that as Christians, we have been adapting to our world from the very beginning. So the story that we heard today in Scripture was from the second chapter of Acts. The church was brand new. People were trying to figure out what being the church meant. And they were living together, and they were eating together, and they were praying together. They were helping one another. And at the end of the scripture today, did you hear those words? People were coming to know Christ daily. New people were joining daily the church. And it was amazing. So I did a little research about the power of us, all of us, you and me. You see, all of us have lived through this pandemic. All of us have contributed in one way or another to the changes that are happening in our world. And all of us have participated in the work of this church. Whether it be online, whether it be delivering sunshine bags, whether it be gathering school and health kits, whether it be building ramps, however we have been about the work of the church, all of us have been doing it together. So Paul gives us this list, and it is a huge list of the things that we need to be about to be the church. So are you ready for your laundry list of things to do over the next few weeks? Paul says, greet one another. Hey, how y'all doing? Check. Be devoted to one another. Be devoted to one another? That means take care of one another. Honor one another. Uh-oh, it's getting harder. Build up one another. Love one another. Live in harmony with one another. Bear one another's burdens. Be kind to one another. Accept one another. Bear with each other. Forgive one another. Teach one another. Encourage one another. Serve one another. Pray for one another. As I was going through that list, a little bell went off inside of my head. And I figured out that the founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley, is a copycat. John Wesley's rules for living: do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. He pared it down. Do all the good you can with everything that you have. You see, that's what we are called to be as the church. And this time of disorientation that we have called a pandemic has forced us to think outside of the box. Bible studies that met online, meetings that didn't occur, or Zoom meetings that occurred, times when we had to deal with each other from a distance. That was one of the hardest things, was not being able to sit down and visit with people. It's been amazing. He's not here today, so I can talk about him. Ted has started coming back. My father-in-law has started coming back to church. And he is so excited about that. Now, he has good days and bad days. Evidently, today was a bad day. He's not here with us today. But it has been fun to see him come back to church. He was so excited. It had been, I think it had been over a year. And that first Sunday he came back, he said to me, I can go to church? And I said, yeah, Marla's going to pick you up. He said, I can go to church? He was so excited to get back together. So we've had to struggle with that. People who have postponed funerals because of this crazy pandemic. We put off my brother's funeral for 5 or 6 months because of the pandemic. People who cannot visit their loved ones in the hospital through sickness and even through death. This pandemic has changed us all. But our job as Christians, like it was for the early Christian church, was to adapt to the conditions. They were meeting together, they were eating together, they were living together, they were praying together. They were studying together. The apostles were teaching and preaching. We as the church have that same mission, that same responsibility. Paul talks about it in his letters to the different churches of what we're supposed to be and do for one another. John Wesley rewrote it in such a way as that we would know what it is that we were supposed to do for each other. The message remains the same. It's just that now it's broadcast online live. It's saved for eternity on YouTube. We still have the same responsibility that we have always had, which is to help others with the love of God. And I want to say that you have done a great job, and I want to encourage you as we go back into a time where we may be restricted on movement, we may be restricted on face coverings, we may be restricted in how it is that we live our lives. I want to encourage you to stay connected with one another, because the power of us really is our connection with one another. Love one another. Honor one another. Pray with one another. And we will overcome the difficulties that we face. And we will make a difference in our world for God. Will you pray with me? God of grace and mercy, we give thanks. Help us to see you and to follow you into a world that is in need of your love and forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. Another change in our world. Communion has been different. If you don't have that lovely little cup, you can go ahead and get one now. On the night he was betrayed, Christ took a loaf, he broke it, he passed it to his disciples. And he told them, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. And at the end of the meal, he took a cup. He lifted up, he gave thanks, and he passed it to his disciples and he said, take, drink. This is my blood, the blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, remember me. We come today to celebrate. Here in this place, physically and online, to celebrate God's love for us and his grace made real through his life and death and resurrection. In the United Methodist tradition, everyone is welcome at God's table. Communion is available to all. It doesn't matter whether you're male or female, it doesn't matter the color of your skin. It doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor or young or old. All are welcome at Christ's table. Will you pray with me? Holy Spirit, I ask your presence here on these, your people, that they would know your love for them and your sacrifice that frees us from sin. And Lord, that these elements, that this cup and this wafer would be for us the body and blood of Christ. Lord, Thank you for this gift. And thank you for your love of us that frees us from sin. We do this to remember that great act of love. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you'll take the wafer, the body of Christ broken for you. And the cup, the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks this day for you, who sets us free from sin. And Lord, we give thanks for this communion together, and we remember that forgiveness, not just for today, but for all days to come, through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth from this place and share with the world the power of us. In Jesus' name, amen.